Well, we want to wish you a happy Father's Day. To all those who are watching online, happy Father's Day as well. Today's message is for fathers, for all men in general, for everybody else. You know why? Because it's about making a difference, and that includes everybody. Everybody. Men, women, and fathers. This is kind of a difficult topic for me because I preached on Father's Day before, and how many times can you preach on the same topic over and over and over again and come up with something kind of new? But once in a while, we got to come up with something that places emphasis in the times in which we find ourselves. And so what I want to do is I want to talk about today how we can make a noticeable difference and a lasting difference in our society. And we need to go ahead and do that, make a noticeable and lasting difference in our society. If you're a man and you want to make a huge difference, a lasting difference, this message is going to be for you. Also, I want to just say this, that we do not want to go ahead and live a mediocre kind of a life. We don't want to submerge ourselves into mediocrity or anonymity, because we want to go ahead and we want to become more than what we want to become, more than what others want us to become. We want to become what God wants to become. So if you want to make a huge impact, I can tell you right now, four things about you, and I don't even know you that well, but if you want to make a huge impact in this world, I believe these four things are true about you. Number one, you're not the kind of guy who's motivated by money or possessions. Yeah, you don't care about that, because money or possessions are not what it takes to make an impact. Number two, you're not the kind of guy who's interested in impressing people. Yeah, you're not a people pleasing. Men of God who want to make an impact are not people pleasing. Number three, you're not the kind of guy who is driven by applause or accolades. Yeah, you don't care if somebody gives you a pat on the back. Your work is to honor Jesus. You don't want to get any special recognition. That's why we're simple people. We're simple people because we know on this Father's Day, if we're simple, then on Mother's Day, we're going to be simple too. Yeah, there's a method to our madness here. And number four, you're not the kind of guy who's afraid to take risks, accept hardships, to embrace difficulties and make sacrifices, because you know to make a difference, that's what it's going to take. So these things are all part of a life, a part of a man's life who desires strongly to make a positive difference, a positive impact, starting with his own personal life, and then his family, his church, his environment, and his own community. That's what men of God want to do. Only one thing matters to you, and that is that you make a difference for all eternity. So this kind of life that we're going to talk about isn't the kind of life that just happens. You're not born this way. God has to give you that desire, that drive. It's not automatic. It is based on who you are, what you do, and why you do it. And so our text, and it's in your notes, is going to be in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 10 to 14. Follow with me as I read these verses. 2 Timothy 3, 10 to 14. But you, Timothy, certainly know what I teach and how I live and what my purpose in life is. You know my faith, my patience, my love, my endurance. You know how much persecution and suffering I have endured. You know all about how I was persecuted in Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra. But the Lord rescued me from all of it. Yes, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. But evil people and imposters will flourish. They will deceive others, and they themselves will be deceived. And then verse 14 he says, but you must remain faithful to the things you have been taught, and know that they are true. For you know that you can trust those who taught you. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word today. We thank you for our fathers. We thank you for the men in this church. We thank you for the women who are also part of this church, part of the lives of the men. And so now we ask, Lord, that you'll take your word, solidify it to our heart and our soul. Make us that man of God you want us to be, so we can make a lasting difference in the life you called us to be. We thank you in Christ's name. Amen. Now, in these verses, Paul the older is going to be talking to Timothy the younger. And Paul is actually near death. And he's about to come to an end, but Timothy, by the way, is basically just getting started. And as Paul is coming to the end of his life, Timothy is real deep in neck deep in ministry. In fact, I'm convinced that Paul is more concerned about Timothy's future than Timothy is about his own future. Now, before we move into our text, here are a couple of things, man, we need to know and understand if we want to make a difference. It's found in the context of this passage. And it's number one, first, to make a difference, you must be different from those around you. That's common sense. If we're going to be different, we have to be different from those around us. Look at verse 1 of chapter 3. You know this, Timothy, that in the last days, there will be very difficult times. Why will the times be difficult? Verse 2. For people will love only themselves and their money. And men who want to be different are not going to be like that. They will be boastful and proud and scoffing at God, disobedient to their parents and ungrateful. Men who want to be different are not going to be like that. They will consider nothing sacred. They will be unloving and unforgiving. They will slander others and have no self-control. They will be cruel and hate what is good. Men who want to be different are not going to be like this. They will betray their friends. They will be reckless, puffed up with pride, and love pleasure rather than God. Men who are different, who want to be different, are not going to be like this. They will act religious, but they will reject the power that could make them godly. Stay away from men like that. And so men of God who want to be different are not going to follow into the same footsteps as these. They will be different from those who are around them. That's a given. And by the way, look at that phrase, very difficult times. The Greek word means harsh, hard to deal with. And we get a better sense of that word from Matthew chapter 8, verse 28. When Christ arrived on the other side of the lake, the region of the Gadarenes, two men who were possessed by demons met him. They came out of the tomb and were so violent that no one could go through that area. Those words, so violent, is the same word, very difficult times. In other words, the time that we are living in is going to be so violent, so difficult, so harsh. That is what is going to take for you to be the man of God, or the context by which you're going to be the man of God. It's not going to be an easy thing. You're not going to just cruise through life in a comfortable position. You're going to have to go ahead and push through, persevere through, to make a difference in times that are very, very difficult. That's the context of what he's saying. And so if you're going to make a difference, it's going to take work and effort and a lot of push and give and take. And so I want to ask us men, do we have what it takes? Do we have what it takes to be that kind of man of God? In almost every church, there's a majority who have embraced the quality of the world. Almost every church is like that. There's always that little minority that has it. In fact, I was going through with the Men of the Word Bible study yesterday. I took them through Revelation chapters 2 and 3, the seven churches there in Asia Minor. And I showed them that Ephesus, when Ephesus began, it was all Christians. All Christians. And then when it went to the other church, there were a handful of unbelievers that came into the church. And then when it went to the third church, a little bit more unbelievers. And the fourth church, a little bit more unbelievers. And it began to take control. When you finally get to Laodicea in chapter 3, it's all unbelievers. Christians were now extinct from the church. And so it's going to take a man of God to stay faithful and say, you know what? I am not going to blend into the world. I am not going to blend in with my contemporaries. I am going to be different because I'm a man of God, and I'm going to be different from those around me. Second, to make a difference, you must avoid those who choose to be like the present times. You must avoid. Look at verse 5. Stay away from people like that. There you go. Stay away. He doesn't even say go around and evangelize them, because they've already been evangelized. They're in the church. But they just choose to be different. They choose to be stubborn, and they choose to live in their unbelief. So Paul tells Timothy, just stay away from people like this. And by the way, in this context, he also tells us three ways that we can learn. There's three ways that we can learn in life if we're going to be men who are going to make a difference. Number one, we can learn by listening to counsel or listening to instructions. Verses 1 to 5, he says, you should know this. And then he talks about what they should know. Difficult times will come. People will be like this. And so we learn, first of all, by instructions. When somebody gives us counsel or instructions. Number two, you learn from the example of others. When somebody else makes a mistake, you learn from that example. Verse 6, they are the kind who work their way into people's homes. They win the confidence of vulnerable women who are burdened by the guilt of sin, controlled by various desires. Such women are forever following new teachings, but they are never able to understand the truth. And he says this, these teachers oppose the truth just as, in other words, in example, Jannes and Jambres, who opposed Moses. They have depraved minds and have counterfeit faith, but they won't get very far for very long. Someday everyone will recognize what fools they are. Let me give an example, he says, just as Jannes and Jambres. So we learn by instructions. When somebody tells us an instruction, we learn. Or we learn by following an example. The third way we learn by personal experience. Personal experience. Verse 14 of chapter 4. Paul says this, Alexander the coppersmith did me much harm. What are you talking about? A personal experience. I can testify, Paul says, from personal experience, this man, Alexander, stay away from. He did me much harm. This is not something that I heard about. This is not something I read about. But I've experienced it myself. He did me much harm. But the Lord will judge him for what he has done. So be careful of him. He's giving instruction. For he fought against everything we said. Now, when you look at these three things, which is the best way to learn? Well, the first way is the best way to learn. You learn by instruction. When somebody tells you, don't do this, receive it. Don't do that. Or go ahead and do this, receive it. Do that. That's a good way to learn. The second good way to learn is you watch somebody else. If somebody else by example, does something wrong and pays for it, you learn from that. Whew, glad that wasn't me. You learn from that, right? Because you watch what happened to somebody else. The third way is by consequences, when you have to learn it yourself and you have to experience it yourself. This comes with a price. I'll give you an example. Where I work, there's a basement, and the pipes are low. And we are told, we are counseled, that when you walk through this basement, put your head down, because there's pipes. And so we listen to counsel, we listen to instruction, we walk through this basement with our head down. One day I was walking in a basement, and I had a guy in front of me, and he didn't put his head down, and boom! And I saw that, because I was behind him, and I thought, oh, that's right, I got to make sure I keep my head down. See, I learned by instructions, and then secondly, I learned by example. You know what would be the bad way to learn? By experience. When you walk through, boom, get hit on the head, that comes with a price, because now you're in pain. But oftentimes, people don't want to learn by instructions. Even by examples, they don't want to learn. They have to go through the mess themselves. And Paul says, you know what? I want to spare you the hurt. I want to spare you the pain. Watch out for Alexander the coppersmith. Stay away from him, because if you get near him, if you get close to him, he will do you much harm. So be careful, because he fought against everything we stood for. Verses 10 to 14, Paul is going to show us men how to make a difference by helping us to look at things from three perspectives or three directions. Number one, in your notes, learn from the past. You're going to make a difference, man. You've got to learn from the past. But you, Timothy, certainly know what I teach and how I live. and what my purpose in life is. You know my faith, my patience, my love, my endurance. Now watch verse 11. You know how much persecution and suffering I have endured, ED. You know all about how I was persecuted, ED, in Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra. And the Lord rescued, ED, me from all of life. In other words, it's all in the past. That ED is a sign to indicate that he's talking about the past. Paul says, remember the close associations we had, Timothy? How you learned from me various things and teachings? Don't let those things go. Don't forget what you've been taught. Remember the things that you learned from me and others in the past, because if you remember those things, verse 14, you're going to remain faithful in the things that you have been taught. Now let me pause for a moment. Think back. Who has deposited into your life some spiritual nugget? Who has deposited into your life some spiritual nugget? Was it parents? You say, no, Pastor Rich, not my parents. My parents were anti-God. They were physically and verbally abusive, and they wanted nothing to do with God. Sounds a little bit like my parents. Wanted nothing to do with God whatsoever. But you know what? God taught me throughout the years that one way in which God teaches us is through negative examples. Oftentimes we think that the only way that we can receive some truth in our lives is by a positive example. But oftentimes God will bring something negative into our lives that can teach us the truth as well. My parents taught me a lot of things in the negative way, and I received it. In fact, let me give an example here. Proverbs 24. Watch this. Proverbs 24. It's in your notes. I walk by the field of a lazy person, the vineyard of one with no common sense. Now, he's never going to meet this person. He's not going to meet this person who he calls lazy. He's not going to meet the person who he says has no common sense. But he says this in verse 31. I saw that his yard was overgrown with nettles, wild plants. It was covered with weeds. The walls were broken down. And so he's getting an image of what the person looks like and is like in the house, although he's never met the person. And then verse 32, he says this. As I looked, I pondered, I thought about it, I learned this lesson. A little extra sleep, a little more slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest, then your poverty will pounce on you like a bandit, scarcity will attack you like an armed robber. You see what he's doing here? He's taking a negative situation and he's learning something positive from it. Amazing. You see, if you see the negative and you don't learn something from the negative, then you're missing out on what God is trying to teach you. Because if you only learn from the positive, you could be learning maybe 50% of what God wants you to learn. But if you learn from the negative, you could be learning much more than just the 50%. And so sometimes when God will bring something or someone into your life that's negative, and you'll learn from it. Like for me today, I learned that it's always good to put the gift in the car the night before. A very negative situation. I'm driving over here. And, oh, I'm already halfway here and I can't turn around. Oh, Lord, what have I learned? Put the thing in the car the night before. Yes, Lord. Amen. So you can learn from the negative, and you should learn from the negative, because a lot of things are going to happen into your life that are negative. Receive it. Because remember, God has no accidents. Nothing in your life comes by accident. Every single thing, positive and negative, is for a purpose of teaching you something about what he wants you to know. You know how we oftentimes shoot ourselves in the foot? By not taking time to listening to the kupunas that God brings into our lives. If God brings into your life a kupuna, and that man or that elderly person, woman, sits down and shares his life story and talks about the past, talks about the days of growing up, do yourself a favor and listen to him or her. God has that person alive for a reason, and the younger generation will greatly benefit by listening to the older. And that's what the Bible says, that the older shall teach the younger. Never get to the point in your life where you think, oh, I don't want to hear that. You're old. What do you got to tell me? I tell you, the kapunas have a lot to tell us. And if we turn our minds off to them, we are doing ourselves a disservice. So we learn from the past. Church, let me just say this. Every eye, I want every eye looking at me when I say this. Don't forget the spiritual gems that your former pastor has passed on to you for the last 20 plus years. Hear what I'm saying? God had that former pastor here for a reason. 20 plus years he poured his life into this church. On a regular basis. Not only did he teach, but he lived out his example before you. Don't ever forget what you learned from your former pastor. Don't ever do that. You'll be doing yourself a disservice if you do. You know how you can honor your former pastor? How you can recognize him and honor him? 2 Timothy 2:2 says this. You have heard me teach things that have been confirmed by many reliable witnesses, Paul says. Now, teach these truths to other trustworthy people who will be able to pass them on to others. So here's what it looks like. The way that you can honor your former pastor is when he went ahead and taught you some things, either by example or verbally, take those same things that he taught you, apply them to your life, and then pass them on to others. When you do that, you are honoring your former pastor. Nothing will make a pastor more joyful than to see his children walking in the truth. It really will. So before I leave my first point, I just want to encourage you to select carefully people who are trustworthy in your life. Select those people and surround yourself with trustworthy people. A counselor will assist you to some degree. A professor will fill your head with knowledge. But a true friend who's not afraid to tell you your blind spots, that's the person you want in your life. Somebody who's not afraid to tell you what blind spots you have. Proverbs 27:6 says this. It says, wounds from a sincere friend are better than kisses from an enemy. Right? Yeah, rather that I be wounded by somebody who's my friend than have many kisses from somebody who's an enemy. So learn from the past. Number two, prepare for the future. Look at verse 12. Yes, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. But evil people and imposters will flourish. They will deceive others and will themselves be deceived. What are you talking about? The future. This will happen. Persecution will take place. Now, I don't want to discourage you, but I want to prepare you. You are in for some really tough times, man. This world isn't getting any easier. Life isn't going to get any easier. Things are going to get rough. Persecution will intensify, and this world does not have on its agenda a high priority in loving Christians. That's not even on the agenda. So things are going to get tough. My point is this. It's going to take a high price for us to pay, men, if we're going to make a difference. A very high price. You're going to receive opposition from those who want to receive or remain in their darkness. You're going to receive that, those opposition. You're going to receive opposition from members of your extended family, your friends, and some in the church. But you got to hang in there. You got to pay the price. Why? Because you're a man that wants to make a difference. Not everyone will be applauding your determination to make a difference. Your message will be censored, mocked, and torn apart as being foolish. You got to be tough. You got to be a man. You got to hang in there. You got to persevere. Now, why is this going to be hard as Christians? Number verse 13 says, evil people and imposters will flourish. They will deceive others and will themselves be deceived. Yeah. People are going to get worse and worse and worse. And that's the kind of environment that you're going to find yourself growing up in. Trusting people, folks, will not come easy. In fact, it's a wise thing not to trust too many people. Let me give you three things that I do, that I learned by experience, by a lot of bumps on the head, to keep me from overly trusting people. Now, I still get hurt now and then, but not as much as I used to. So let me give you three things. Don't trust someone who's not committed to the word. You come across somebody who's not committed to the word, you can have fellowship in terms of, you know, casual acquaintances, but don't enter into a deep relationship with that person. You'll regret it. Why? Because the word establishes in your heart convictions. And you're going to want to be with somebody that has convictions. They know what is right and wrong, and they know what hill to die on. The very thing that will carry you through from year to year, from month to month, is not just knowledge of the word alone, although that's important, but it's that personal conviction that you receive from the word. You see, you got to stand for something or you're going to fall for anything. That's why I like the bookmark reading that we're passing out, that people are doing. We're reading through the bookmarks together, and people are formulating their convictions. This is what God wants me to do. This is what God is saying to me. And they're sharing it with the rest of everybody else. And it's great. Some of the things that we are seeing is just super. I've seen Christians with weak convictions, and they will choose man's way over God's way. This is the reason why the devil will often use fear in our lives, because people with weak convictions will be succumbed by fear easily. We choose the world's remedies rather than God's remedies. And so fear creates doubt. You say, well, Pastor Rich, you know me, I'm not one that likes to get involved in politics. Well, you know what? Let me just say this. You may not want to get involved in politics, but politics is involved with you. Because when they go ahead and they pass a law, it affects you. When they go ahead and they do something that affects you, it affects your freedom, it affects the way you live, it affects your money, it affects your finances, it affects everything. It affects gas. You may not want to get involved, but it gets involved with you. So form your convictions, because you know what politics is? Morality. Just from a political standpoint. But it's morality. And Christians are involved in morality, right? The whole book of the Bible is about moral living. So you're going to have to live a moral life, so might as well live it with God's intention and not with man's intention. Firm up your convictions. You have to know what hill you're going to die on. What is important to you? What battles are worth fighting for? And what battles are saying, you know what, I don't want to go in and fight that. When I formulate my convictions and my convictions become stronger and stronger throughout the years, I know how to say no to a lot of things that come my way. And I say yes to just a few things. Why? Because of convictions. That's why we place in this church our focus on four areas that are absolute importance. Four areas: worship, instruction, fellowship, evangelism. That's it. We don't get involved in anything that doesn't involve one of these four areas. We keep it simple. But when you look at these four things, which is the most critical of the four? You say, well, they're all critical. Well, yes and no. There is one that's most critical of the four. Let's take, for example, worship. Is worship critical? Well, when we get together and we worship like we did today, that's great. We go ahead and we just close our eyes and we worship the Lord. And not only in church, but we worship the Lord throughout the week. That is awesome. Worship is very important. But you know what? In heaven, guess what you're going to be doing in heaven? You're going to be worshiping God. Yep. and you're going to be doing a lot better. Because right now, we get distracted. We got to deal with time and space. We got to deal with the heat and everything. In heaven, we won't deal with any of that. We get to worship God like we never worshiped before, right? What about instructions? Well, we learn like right now, we're learning things, and then there's comprehension, and then sometimes we, you know, our minds wander because we're thinking about what we're going to eat and what we're going to do, or like me, we're thinking about the McDonald's that's taking place in another hour or so. We're thinking about all kinds of things, and so, but in heaven, we're going to be taught firsthand by Jesus Christ like we've never been taught before. So we learn here, and we're going to learn up there. How about fellowship? Fellowship is important. Getting together, sometimes it's so hard to get together because of our schedules. It's hard to pull everybody together because of all the things that are going on. And when we are together, sometimes we may not feel good. Sometimes we may have to distance ourselves for physical reasons and so forth. Fellowship is oftentimes can be a little bit limited down here, but up there, fellowship is going to be unlimited. What about evangelism? Now think with me on this. We reach out to people here and bring them to Christ. In heaven, that will never ever take place. Unlike worship, which will, unlike instruction, which will, unlike fellowship, which will take place in heaven, evangelism, if we don't get it right here, we don't do it a second time. See what I'm talking about? If we don't bring people to Christ now, we don't get a second chance. If we don't bring people in church now, we don't get a second chance. If we don't reach out to our neighbors now, we don't get a second chance in heaven. That's why I say of the four, evangelism is the most critical. Because in heaven, we get to do the other three. On earth, in heaven, if we don't do evangelism now on earth, we don't ever do it again in heaven. It's the most critical thing to do. That's why sometimes when things are a little bit tough, we tend to look for greener pastures. And so what do? We change our jobs, we move to different areas, we change churches, we change our boyfriends, we go ahead and cheat on our spouse because we're looking for greener grass. But let me ask this, the grass on the other side may not be greener, it may not be edible. Have you thought about that? Never mind how green it is, can you even enjoy it? By the way, I want to commend, I call them the remnant in this church. I want to commend them for hanging tough. When I came, just a remnant of people here, strong, committed, hanging in there, and they're just one tough group. What would you expect from Waianae? Yes. See, I haven't even given the invitation yet, and people are coming forward. That's how powerful the Holy Spirit is. People ask me, but Pastor, does that bother you when kids run? No, absolutely not. Suffer the little children to come, right? Let them come. They're good examples. But yeah, just like the remnant, the little core people that we have in this church, thank God that they're committed, that they want to make a difference. So if you want to make a difference, learn from the past, learn from the prepare for the future, and then number three, remain faithful in the present. Remain faithful in the present. Verse 14, but you must remain faithful to the things you've been taught. You know how they are true. You know that you can trust those who taught you these things. Listen, you have no idea where God is going to take you. You have no idea what tomorrow is like. You think you may do, but you don't have no clue whatsoever. But whatever God does to your life and whatever God does in terms of bringing you along, always remember to remain faithful. Even if it's the small things. You might be just somebody who just does something very small, but if you remain faithful in that small task that God has given you, you don't know what kind of task God is going to give you tomorrow. That's going to be huge. Why? Because you remain faithful in what God has given you now. Remain faithful. Like Job, when God tries you, he will try you in such a way that you would want to declare what Job declared when he was tempted and tested. Listen to what he said in Job 23:10. He says, God knows where I'm going, Job says. And when he tests me, I want to come out as pure as gold. For I have stayed on God's path. I have not wavered. I have followed his ways and have not turned aside. I have not departed from his commands, but have treasured his words more than my daily food. What is he saying? He's saying, men, fathers, if we're going to make a difference, if we're going to be different, it's going to take a spirit of courageousness. That's how it's going to make a difference. We have to have a spirit of courageousness if we're going to be men who are going to make a difference. I want you to see this next video, that we want to show you on how to be a man of God who's courageous, and some of the things that you're going to be taught through instructions and also by example. Take a look.
As a law enforcement officer, I've seen firsthand the deep hurt and devastation that fatherlessness brings in a child's life. Our prisons are full of men and women who have lived recklessly after being abandoned by their fathers, wounded by the men who should have loved them the most. Many of these children now follow the same pattern of irresponsibility that their fathers did. While so many mothers have sacrificed to help their children survive, they were never intended to carry the weight alone. We thank God for them. But research is proving that a child also desperately needs a daddy. There's no way around this fact. As you know, earlier this year, my family endured the tragic loss of our 9-year-old daughter, Emily. Her death forced me to realize that not only had I not taken advantage of the priceless time I had with her, but that I did not truly understand how crucial my role was as a father to her and our son Dylan. Since her passing, I've asked God to show me through his word how to be the father that I need to be. I now believe that God desires for every father to courageously step up and do whatever it takes to be involved in the lives of his children. But more than just being there, providing for them, he's to walk with them through their young lives and be a visual representation of the character of God, their Father in heaven. The father should love his children and seek to win their hearts. He should protect them, discipline them, and teach them about God. He should model how to walk with integrity and treat others with respect. He should call out his children to become responsible men and women who live their lives for what matters in eternity. Some men will hear this and mock it or ignore it. But I tell you that as a father, you are accountable to God for the position of influence he has given you. You can't fall asleep at the wheel only to wake up one day and realize that your job or your hobbies have no eternal value, but the souls of your children do. Some men will hear this and agree with it, but have no resolve to live it out. Instead, they will live for themselves and waste the opportunity to leave a godly legacy for the next generation. But there are some men who, regardless of the mistakes we've made in the past,
fathers, everyone, if we want to make a difference, whether we're a father, whether we're a man, whether we're a woman, we must learn from the past, we must prepare for the future, and we must be faithful in the present. Nothing short of being courageous is going to do. Amen. and we'll make a difference by God's grace. Let's pray. Father, we echo the message of this video as well as the eternal message of your word. When Isaiah was challenged and called out, and you said, who will I send? Who will go before me? Isaiah said, send me. Or in other words, I will. And so Heavenly Father, we want to echo that as a church. Who's going to make a difference in this world? Who's going to make a difference in Waianae? Who's going to make a big spiritual difference in our home, in our church, in our schools, in our communities, where we work? The answer is, I will. I will make the difference. By your grace, I will. So Father, I want to pray for every man and woman, every father, every mother, every child. Lord, give us your power to make that difference. Give us your strength, Father, to know the difference of how we need to live our lives, not to be like the rest of the world, but to be different, so different that we make a difference. Because the only way that we're going to stop the erosion of society and stop the erosion that's going on in our schools and stop the erosion that's going on in our society, Father, is we have to rise up, and like men and women of God, we have to say, I will. Nothing short of being courageous in the Holy Ghost is going to do. So, Father, we are your vessels. Use us for your honor and glory. And we'll give you the praise and thanksgiving. In your name we pray. Amen.